It's Wednesday night, and we're studying predestination in all of its facets. When I'm saying all of its facets, I mean all of the words that would be related to it. I've got some words that I haven't even talked about in a long time. It's about how God preordains everything. He has created good and evil, and even the Sabbath is created by God. But we're not talking about the seventh day, every seventh day. The Sabbath is more than every seventh day. The word Sabbath, Sabbath, means to rest. And the word rest has a definition, Sabbath, or Sabbath. There's various ways to spell it. Sabbatismos, Sabbatismos. Anything in the Old Testament that had a ritual to it, we really need to understand that the rituals were blotted out. The Bible is composed of the very image and the shadow. Shadow, of that's Hebrews 10 and 1 says, the law having a shadow of good things to come, it is not the very image. The image is what casts a shadow. Well, how in the world could the shadow be here first, and the very image is the New Testament? Because of the very thing we've been talking about, that God preordained everything before the foundation of the world. He's chosen us in Him before the foundation of the world, but He's chosen us to be the very image. And God wrote all these things down in the Old Testament to be a shadow. A shadow is just a pointer. Whenever you go outside and you cast a shadow, it points to the very image that you are casting to the ground. So if you want to know what something's really about, turn and look at the image and not the shadow. Now, the Bible says that the Sabbath was a shadow. So it's not the real thing. Every 7 days is not the real thing. When you go back over here to Colossians, I'm going to point it out to you again. Galatians, Ephesians, Philippians, Colossians, the Bible says that I got to point out something to you. Sometimes I don't get it as clear as I should when the Bible says here in verse 8 of chapter 2, beware lest any man spoil you. You can be spoiled by something. The word spoil is the word sulagogeo, S-O-U-L-O, sulagogeo, A-G-O-A-G-O-G-E-O. That word spoil means to lead into captivity. And He names what will lead you away captive. And He starts naming rituals. People say, what's wrong with dipping people in water? It is a ritual. It'll make you think that's all there is to it. The preacher won't think anything about spiritual baptism. Spiritual baptism is a baptism of blood. It's a baptism of fire. They're all the same thing. Spiritual baptism is a blood baptism. It is a fiery baptism. It's a baptism of fire. It's a baptism of truth, because the Word of God is truth. And the Bible says, John 17, 17, Thy Word is truth, and it is spiritual. The Spirit is the truth. The Bible says that the Spirit is the truth, John 14, 15, 16, John 15, 26, John 16, 13, 1 John 5 and 6. The Spirit is truth, and the Word of God is truth, John 17, 17. So the Word of God is the Spirit, is the truth, it's the Spirit. And a blood baptism was a death, and when you tell people truth, you go through a blood baptism, and the Bible calls that a fire. So they're all the same. Well, if you do the literal baptism and you try to do the, if you try to get something spiritual out of washing people in water, that's not what you need to be doing. It will lead you off into captivity. People, I didn't mean to get into this tonight, but I've had people this past week say, well, what is the water if it's not to be implemented into the church? The water was, gosh, I hate to go back here, but it was, especially right now, it was the halakha. And the halakha was brought into the church, brought into Israel from ancient Israel. It actually comes from the temple. The water baptism was put into Israel by the rabbis of the Babylonian synagogue, which was corruption. This is where the water comes from, right here. This is the brazen sea. Every morning, the Levites, particularly the priests, sons of Aaron, they had all these rituals had to do with the temple. They were doing things all day long, rituals. Well, they would come to the brazen sea every morning before the priests of God would go to this altar, this brazen altar. Brazen means brass. Now, some say it wasn't made of brass. It was possibly made of copper. I don't know. Nobody really knows. And that this brazen sea was made of brass. And then all the instruments inside this temple were made of gold, beaten gold. Of course, it was gold wrapped around wood. And you had the altar of incense, and you had the Ark of the Covenant. The baptism came from this, from the brazen sea. They would come there every morning, the priests would, and wash themselves all over. And then they had prescribed sacrifices they made through the day. Sometimes they had to go into the holy place. This is the Holy of Holies. This is the holy place. They'd go into the holy place, and they would sanctify themselves by offering usually a young bullock for the priest, and they'd have to sanctify the sanctuaries. Sanctuary comes from the word saint. Hagios means holy. So they would have to purify themselves and then go about doing all the different rituals through the day. They had a ton of them. Well, then after the first sacrifice in the morning, they'd come back to the brazen sea, and they had bronze bulls that would be, their heads would be facing outward, and they had 12 of them holding up the brazen sea. And I'm sure they were made of brass also. And they would wash at the little spigot here. They have a little spigot, wash all over. Then they would come up here, offer sacrifice. They would come back to this spigot and wash their hands and their feet. And what they did, they took these washings from this. When Israel was carried away into captivity, southern Judah particularly, they were carried over to Babylon. And in Babylon, they needed a place of worship. So what they did is they organized the synagogue, the Babylonian synagogue. Who did this? Well, the Levites from over here. Now, they were guilty. They were guilty of having gone after Baal in the grove and all these gods, and they had never repented of these gods when they were carried away. When they were carried away over here to Babylon, they did not repent. So here they are, real religious, real phony religious, real religious in Babylon. And over in Babylon, they said, we need a place of worship. So they organized the Babylonian, S-Y-N-A-G-O-G-U-E. They organized a synagogue over here. They said, we need a law to go by. Well, we are self-righteous Levites. We'll start calling ourselves rabbis, which means master or teacher. Well, this has been destroyed by Nebuchadnezzar. What we'll do is to take the first five books of the Bible, and that's called the law or Torah. And we will translate these five books out of the Hebrew, and we will translate it into the Aramaic, which is a Babylonian dialect of Hebrew. But just because you can understand, Aramaic doesn't mean you can understand Hebrew. That's like Italian is a Latin language, and so is Spanish. Just because you can speak Italian doesn't mean you can speak Spanish, and vice versa. Well, this was a stuttering sound. It sounded like Hebrew being stuttered. That's what it sounded like. So they said, we'll translate it over. And since we are the masters of theology, and we were the Levites over here, we've changed our name to being masters. To being masters, that's what a rabbi was, a teacher. And what they did, I've told you this before, I'm doing this because a lady has been asking me, what is this about? Well, and what will it do if you dip people in water? How can it hurt them? Well, they translated the law over to the Aramaic, but since they were rebellious Levites and have never repented of their sun and tree worship, they do what they want with the law of God when they translate it over to the Babylonian language, the Aramaic. And they pervert the word of God, they wrench the scriptures by putting their own translation onto the scriptures and changing it. So what they do is they take this Aramaic, take these laws, and they say, what you need, besides the translation, you need some commentaries on the translation. So they appoint a head rabbi, and there's some very famous head rabbis. Now, I'm going to tell you what they did. So being rebellious rabbis, rebellious Levites, and they didn't want to change their ways, the reason they were carried away is because they were unrepentant going after these idol gods. So they're not repentant when they get to Babylon. So they will take this law, this law of God, and will put our own spin on it. A spin is your opinion of what these things meant. And this is what will lead you into captivity, is these spins that they put on this. Well, they ended up with Halakha and Haggadah. These were a spoken opinion. It's just the head rabbi that comes in. He could be real liberal and say, I think this means, because I'm not real committed to the Lord. So he says, I'll put my opinion on what I think it means. And the Haggadah, they had this could be written down, but it could not be spoken aloud. This could be spoken aloud, but could not be written down. So therefore, the Halakha is really bad, because the Halakha is just a spoken opinion. And every time a rabbi would die, they had that Babylonian synagogue over 500 years, 560 or 70 years before Jesus. And they're just adding one thing after another. And one thing they added, they took this washing of the brazen sea and they put it into their spoken Halakha. And they said that if you were going to come to Babylon or to Israel and become a member of the kingdom of God, which is another term for Israel, that you had to be circumcised. And of course, we find that's true over there in Exodus, the 12th chapter, when they're leaving Egypt, they said every man that comes into Israel had to be circumcised. God gave that to Abraham in the 17th chapter of Genesis. And they said, so that's it. That's already in the law. They're going to have to do that anyway. And then they said you had to be washed in water, which they called a new birth. But that was an opinion. So that was just an opinion that they added to this Halakha, and it was a verbal law. It was something they said, but they could not write it down. So whoever this rabbi is going to be, they can add every kind of imaginary thing to this. And all of these rabbis knew that a water washing was their opinion that they inserted into this. So they said, if you're going to become a member of the kingdom of God, you had to be circumcised, washed in water, and you also had to offer two turtle doves. That was also in the law, two turtle doves. So this was in the law, this was in the law, but this water washing was not in the law. They added that, and they took it from here. Took it from the brazen sea. That's where they get the foot washing. That is a ritual. When you put foot, they, primitive Baptists, put foot washing into their rituals. If you come into their church, you got to have your feet washed. Well, that was something they washed their hands and their feet here. It's funny how they split it up. It's funny that Jesus, the Pharisees said to Jesus in Matthew 15, why don't your apostles wash their hands before they eat. Now, that's real strange if you actually knew what they did. They had a triclinium table they would lie down at. Triclinium table. They didn't have that goofy looking table that Leonardo da Vinci, the homosexual artist, painted. They had this. Here's what they had. And they would have bowls in front of them, and it would have some kind of bitter herbs or something, and their utensils were their hands. Reach down there and pick a piece of bread up, dip it into the solution and eat. Certainly they washed their hands. What they meant, according to this halakha, they would have a receptacle with water as they would walk into a room, and they're going in there to eat. What they meant is, why don't your apostles dip their hands ritualistically down in this that we inserted from this brazen sea after they'd offered their sacrifices, but they'd wash all over in the morning. Remember, Jesus came to Peter and he said, I'm going to wash your feet. Foot washing was normal in the land back then because they lived in a very arid, hot land. It was a Jewish greeting to wash somebody's feet because they'd swell up, they'd get real hot. Remember, the Lord said one of the miracles that he gave to Israel when they were going through the wilderness, their feet wouldn't swell up and they wouldn't get hot. Now, that was a sign from God. Well, that's why Jesus said to Peter, you've already been washed all over by the Spirit. Peter said, wash me all over. He said, you've already been washed. I'm just going to wash your feet to show you this hospitality of the Jews. It's not something, it's not a ritual he told us to get involved in. So they kept adding all these things. They added that. They added that if we did what they did, we'd put a receptacle over here as we'd walk in the door, and we'd dip our hands in it. And Jesus said to them, now notice it's two different things. He says, you'll be spoiled by these rituals. And Jesus said, you make the word of God of none effect. There in the 15th chapter of John, the word of God is not effectual in your life if you're doing rituals. None effect, of none effect. I'll get it right in a minute. Akarao, A-K-U-R-O-O. He said, if you're doing rituals, just think. If you're dipping somebody in water, if there's one Lord, one faith, and one baptism, and somebody comes up and says, the one baptism is water, you can forget what John the Baptist said. He said, I wash with water. He that comes after me will baptize you with Holy Ghost and fire. You can forget the Holy Ghost and fire. But Holy Ghost and fire was as common a saying as anything in our day and time. Holy Ghost and fire. Holy Ghost, Hagios. That's the word holy. Pneuma, P-N-E-U-M-A. That's the word breath. Breath. So holy pneuma. Breath, pure breath. That was an old saying that went back over 300 years before John the Baptist, close to 400, probably 375 years or more. That was a Stoic saying. And Stoicism, if I just put Stoic, C-I-S-M, Stoicism, this was an old, ancient ritual. It was a philosophy. And a man named Zeno started Stoicism somewhere in the neighborhood of 320 BC. It was a spiritual ritualistic belief. And he said that all the universe, it was a cosmos. K-O-S-M-O-S. Orderly arrangement. And that's the word. Cosmos is the word in John 3:16 for world. Now, I can't help this. If it's the word world, it means orderly arrangement. Whether anybody likes it or not, it is masculine gender. It doesn't mean men. For God, I don't want to get into it. He didn't love the world. He so loved, so is an adverb. Adverbs tell how, when, where, and sometimes why. And they modify verbs, adjectives, and other adverbs. So modifies world, it means in this fashion, love the orderly arrangement. It doesn't mean people. It doesn't mean it. And you get the word kosmikos. Kosmikos is that you look in a Webster dictionary, look up the word cosmetic. It'll tell you it comes from the word kosmikos. And you got several other words, kosmeo. And it means, in fact, this word kosmikos, when the Bible says, let a woman adorn herself in the right kind of fashion, right kind of dress, the word adorn is from this base word, kosmikos, whether people like that or not. Now, where was I? I'm talking about what happens to you when you get involved in rituals. Well, we found out that you make the word of God of none effect, akarao, and it comes from the word kurios, none effect, none effect. Comes from the word kurios, which is the word Lord. And placing the alpha privative in front of that word, it is inspired this way. It's not something I made up. This is the inspired word of God. None effect, akarao. It negates the word kurios. That means no Lord. If you're involved in rituals of any kind for your salvation, Jesus is not your Lord. If you want to dip your hands in water, by twisting his word, men that twist the word of God, which is what the Pharisees did with their halakha, and I've gone through a lot of the things of the halakha. The Haggadah was a written commentary, and they said that couldn't be spoken aloud, and that's got some of the most ridiculous things that's ever been written down by anybody. You could get a set of McClintock and Strong encyclopedias. Look up the word Talmud, T-L-M-U-D. That's a bunch of garbage. You look up Talmud and it'll have halakha in there and have Haggadah, and it'll go through 50 pages of ridiculous statements. It's crazy stuff. So I'm showing you this to show you what'll happen when you go after rituals. First of all, Jesus is not your Lord, because you're going to substitute water baptism for spiritual baptism. There's one Lord, one faith, one baptism. Baptize absolutely does not mean to dip into water or to sprinkle with water. It don't matter whether people believe it or not. You can go into Mr. Girdlestone's book on synonyms of Old Testament Greek words. That's where they translated the Septuagint, and Mr. Girdlestone, one of the great Greek scholars of all time, will tell you that baptized, it was not possible to translate the word into English. He said it was too ambiguous, it had dual meaning, and he said it had two meanings, to cover and to stain with a dye. Even Mr. Strong says that in the Strong's, well, he says it in the Strong's Concordance. He'll tell you in the Concordance, baptizo means to cover, and it comes from bapto, meaning to stain with a dye. He is a brilliant man. This is the same man that produced the Strong's Concordance, McClintock and Strong. And he'll tell you that it means to cover with a stain or dye. So Mr. Girdlestone, G-I-R-D-L-E-S-T-O-N-E, Mr. Girdlestone says they had to anglicize the word in order to get it over to the English language. There was no way to translate it. He said it was not translatable. So what they had to do is to take the word baptizo and bapto and anglicize them, A-N-G-L-E-C-I-Z-E. Anglicize them, and to anglicize, angle means English, means to turn these two words into one English word. Baptizo means to cover, bapto means to stain, or to die. I didn't say that. Mr. Girdlestone says it. Brilliant scholar. Oh, so does Mr. Strong and McClintock and Strong. And so do the whole lot. Most, if you ask any Greek professor in the world, will you lay your life on the line that baptize means to dip in water? They will say, no, I can't do that. If they're scholars of any count, the thing about baptism that bothers me most, the thing about it that bothers me most is John in Matthew, the third chapter, Matthew 3. John says, John the Baptist says, I have a baptism to be baptized with. How am I straitened until it be accomplished? Look at that. This is the most ridiculous thing that preachers have done with the word baptized. This one thing right here, besides the fact that baptized doesn't mean to immerse, and it absolutely does not mean to sprinkle. Are you saying everybody that's been dipped in water is going to hell? No, I'm not saying that. I'm saying if you put any stock in that water, I believe people have been baptized like I was. I was dipped in water about five times by my father and a couple other preachers. And I felt stupid while I was being dipped in water. Has anybody else ever been dipped in water? Did you feel dumb? I felt wet. That's all I felt. And I just thought, this is ridiculous. And it bothered me from the time I was a little kid. I just hated it when it happened. I thought, I'm embarrassed. I'm standing here wet all over. I feel dumb. And there was nothing religious about it. It's a part of that brazen sea. Now, here's what bothers me more than anything about baptism. I'm going to read it and point it out to you while I'm reading it. All right. I never have done that, pointed out while I'm reading. Look here in Matthew. Look in that third chapter. Third chapter. All right. This is John the Baptist crying in the wilderness, the voice of one crying in the wilderness, verse 3. Prepare the way of the Lord, make his path straight. This same John had his raiment of camel's hair, leather girdle about his loins, and his meat was locust and wild honey. Then went out to him Jerusalem and all of Judea, all the region round about Jordan, and were baptized of him in Jordan, confessing their sins. What was that about? That was confessing their sins because Israel had never confessed. And those who were following John were confessing all those sins of following fire and tree worship over there in the Old Testament. And when he saw many of the Pharisees and Sadducees come to his baptism, he said unto them, O generation of vipers, who hath warned you to flee from the wrath to come? Who were these guys? They were the guys that had led Israel into fire and tree worship in the Old Testament. That's why John the Baptist is calling them the names that he's calling them. He called them a generation of vipers. They're poisoning Israel. But they evolved in Jesus' day and time. They evolved into the Pharisees from the Babylonian synagogue, and what they taught was the halakha and the haggadah of this synagogue over here, and they came back from the captivity unrepentant of their fire and tree worship and unrepentant of their twisting the word of God. So rabbis of Babylon are the same thing as the Pharisees. That's what they are. And they were feeding all these rituals of the halakha and the gada to Israel. Now, let's read on here. Bring forth therefore fruits, meat, or axios, deserving or suitable to be works of repentance. He's not saying go out and do ritual. And think not to say within ourselves, we have Abraham to our father, because he's not your father. He told the same guys that in the 8th chapter of John. If God were your father, you would do the things that I say. For I say unto you that God is able of these stones to raise up children unto Abraham. And now also the axe is laid unto the root of the trees. It's laid unto you. He's saying you don't have any fruit. Remember, you can't interpret this alone. Over in the Old Testament, in the book of Leviticus, it was against the law in Deuteronomy, the 20th chapter, those last verse, to kill a fruit tree. But he said, you are a picture of these fig trees, and you don't have any fruit worthy to be called works of repentance. Therefore, every tree which bringeth not good fruit, which is these Pharisees, you don't have any fruit of the Spirit, is hewn down and cast into the fire. Well, that's what they were supposed to do with a fig tree that was 5 years old or older, according to the 19th chapter of Leviticus, or 17th chapter of Leviticus. They were supposed to cut the tree down. I indeed baptize with water unto repentance. He's saying, I'm going to bring people into the kingdom of God because you had to go through these three things, circumcision, washing water, and offer two turtle doves. I'm preaching this for you to be before Jesus died on the cross. When they nailed him to the cross, they nailed all the rituals with him. The Bible says so. But before he's nailed to the cross, they're still keeping all the laws of the Old Testament. The laws of the Old Testament, the rituals didn't stop till Jesus was nailed to the cross. Blotting out the handwriting of ordinances. That comes right after Ephesians 2:8 that I read at the first of this book. first of this message, when we said, beware lest any man spoil you through philosophy and vain deceit, after the traditions of men, after the rudiments of this world, and not after Christ. What he said there in Colossians 2:8, you will be led into captivity through philosophy, philos, sophos. You'll be led into captivity by your affection for your own worldly wisdom. And that's what these rituals will do to you. It's a worldly wisdom. If you run across somebody that believes in water baptism as a ritual, they always believe in crackers and grape juice as a ritual. Most of them believe in Christmas as a ritual. They believe in Easter as a ritual. All of the rituals of the world, they cling to. You can't find a Baptist church that says, we want to do away with the ritual. They will keep their crackers and grape juice and call it communion. And that's not what they were eating. They were eating the last Passover. And there's a spiritual Passover. Now, he said, through philosophy and vain deceit. He said, this will cause you to be led away captive back into darkness. What rituals does to a believer, it leads him into darkness. The Bible says so. He said, that's what those believers in Ephesians 4, that's what led them on a vain search because they were depending on rituals. Rituals are extremely dangerous. It leads you off away from the truth. I'm not ever going to dip anybody in water. I'm not going to ever pass around crackers and grape juice and say, this is the body of Christ, when I've already preached to you there's one body and it's you. It's the church. The body's the church. If you'll notice, everywhere we go, rituals take people and lead them completely away from the truth. If there's one baptism, I got to finish this. Through philosophy and vain deceit, after traditions of men. Tradition is the word paradosis. That is the same word that Jesus used. He said, when you go after these traditions of men, paradosis, then that 15th chapter of Matthew, if you go after the traditions of men, God is not, Jesus is not your Lord. So he says that in the same chapter. He said, if you go after the tradition or the rituals of man, I believe rituals are one of the most dangerous thing in the church that's leading the church away from God, away from Christ. If they like their water, they're certainly going to like crackers and grape juice. If they like that, they're going to like their Christ Mass, which is a total corruption of the Word of God. They're going to like Ishtar. They might as well go down to Mardi Gras because it's the same thing. So he says, let me finish reading this here. And after the traditions of men, after the rudiments of this world, the word rudiment, stoichion, it means rituals. The Jews called all of their rituals that had to do with the tabernacle, they called all those rituals stoichion in the Greek. When they translated the Septuagint over, all the rituals they had around this temple, they called it stoichion. He said, you will be led into darkness by trying to perform rituals that enhance your spirituality. I believe rituals are one of the most dangerous things to the church. In fact, the ritual of the so-called Lord's Supper, which has a different application in all religions, that ritual is what they call when they put it in Catholicism, they called it the sacrament of the Mass, the Eucharist. That have led millions away. I don't believe in any rituals in the church ever, because he said in the same chapter of Colossians, second chapter, 2:8, beware lest any man spoil you through philosophy and vain deceit, after the tradition of men, after the rudiments of this world, not after Christ. And then he says, just after that, let me go back here, I'll come back to this in Matthew 3. But go back to that. He said, these traditions will lead you away. And then he says, you're circumcised with a spiritual circumcision. If the spiritual circumcision, he's telling that to a Colossian Gentile church, if this traditions of men, this circumcision is spiritual, he's telling it to a Gentile church. Before Jesus died, they would have all had to have been circumcised with a literal circumcision, and they would have had to have been dipped in water, and then they would have had to offer two turtle doves. But he says, trying to get this, let me go back over here and I'll come back here. Look here in the Matthew, here's what bothers me about this water, about this cracker and grape juice, more than anything else. John says, I indeed baptize you with water unto repentance, in verse 11. But he that cometh after me is mightier than I, whose shoes I am not worthy to bear. He shall baptize you with Holy Ghost and fire. Pneuma and pur. That was a common term. Pneuma and pur. Everyone knew what that meant. That was a term that Mr. Zeno, I got it up here somewhere, Mr. Zeno had come up with, and he said all the universe was a cosmos, and it was a living, breathing entity. An entity is, I'm an entity. I've got arms and legs and hands and I move around, and I eat, and I drive a car. That's a living entity. And Mr. Zeno just came up with this in his Stoicism. He said, all of this universe, Mars and Venus and Jupiter and the galaxies, it was all one body. And he said, they called it cosmos. And he said, something gave this entity life. He said, what gave them life was pneuma and pur. Pur is the word fire. So when John says, there comes one after me, he'll give you life with pneuma, breath, and fire, pur. It was a common saying. Everyone knew what it meant. Now here's what gets me. John is saying, I've got water. Jesus has pneuma and pur, fire. I've got this. Here's what John's got. And here's what Jesus has got, pneuma and pur. Now, I've said this, but I'm going to take time to stop and go through it real slow. This is Jesus' first appearance on the scene as far as his ministry. And then in chapter 4, he goes into the wilderness. He's tempted of the devil. And then he preaches his first message in chapter 5. That's the Sermon on the Mount. Blessed are ye. All these Beatitudes. And he gets on down here and says, watch out for the scribes and Pharisees, for it hath been said. And he's referring, said, to all their Haggadah rituals. He warns them of the rituals immediately. Now, here's what gets me. We're going all through here, and Jesus is going to walk on water, and he's going to heal the sick and raise the dead Lazarus. And he's going to go all the way through this book, and he's going to be crucified there in chapter 27. And then in 28, he's resurrected from the dead, right? He's resurrected from the dead. Now, in chapter 28, they're up there in Galilee, and he goes up there to see them and talk to them. And there's only 11 apostles left because Judas has killed himself. Verse 16, chapter 28. Then the 11 disciples went away into Galilee, into a mountain where Jesus had appointed them. And when they saw him, they worshipped him, but some doubted. And Jesus came and spake unto them, saying, all power is given unto me. I'm resurrected from the dead. All power is given unto me in heaven and in earth. Go ye therefore, talking to the apostles, and teach all nations, baptizing them with that water that John talked about. You know the one he told you about that I had, holy pneuma and purr. You can forget that one right now, okay? You think that's what he said? Every preacher in the world that I've ever heard will say this is talking about, go to all the world, teach all nations, and baptize them in water. It sounds ridiculous, doesn't it? Especially when this is Jesus, the living God, that's got a baptism of fire of the Holy Spirit of his own. Doesn't it sound ridiculous? I've never heard a preacher preach this, that he wasn't referring to water. And why would John say that back here and say, and then Jesus would repeat, go into all the world baptized with John's water baptism. There's no possible way he means that. Of course, he can't mean that by very essence of the meaning of the word in. That word is en. En. En has the same basic meaning as many of you have been baptized into Christ, have put on Christ. Put on is the word in duo. It means to sink into clothing, but don't come out. He's washed us from our sins in his own blood, and this is our clothing. It's the blood baptism. He did the washing, and the blood baptism is a continuation as we live our daily lives. He did the blood baptizing. Some gal on the internet says, I preach that the people do the blood baptizing. He baptizes us in his own blood, and they continue this because we go out here in the world and preach truth since we're baptized in the blood of Christ, and people want to kill us, which is a blood baptism. It produces this from men that hate the idea that I'm preaching against Christmas and preaching that God doesn't love everybody. So they want to continue this killing us off. So, I can't get for the life of me, since baptized means to cover with a stain or die, for the life of me, I can't get how preachers can say John is talking about two baptisms, and then you get over here with Jesus, and he says go into all the world and teach John's baptism, but that one John said about me, since you don't know what Holy Ghost and fire is, it means life. I'll sit down with any doctor of theology and say this to him. And there's much more to talk about than just this right here. Now, so, and I was saying that, I was talking to a lady today, and she says, I'm struggling with this. Well, there's lots of things to say about it, but there's one Lord, one faith, one baptism. When Paul said that to the Ephesians, he said that to them in in Ephesians, the fourth chapter. And that was approximately 57 A.D. Well, he died on the cross in 33 to 35 A.D. Some people try to nail it down at 33, but 35. And when he was nailed to the cross, he blotted out the handwriting of ordinances. All the rituals were blotted out. This is what I was getting at first. Let's go back over there and look at that. Colossians 2. Now, Colossians was a Gentile church. And they, in order to be a believer, in order to be in Israel and to partake of Israel's, all the rituals of Israel, the rituals were there when Jesus died. And when he died, they were blotted out. Two parts to the law. The Spirit. Paul tells us that in 2 Corinthians, the third chapter. The Spirit and the letter. The letter killeth. The letter is the rituals. That's performing all these things they did here, which would include the Sabbath day. The Sabbath day was a ritual. They were doing, even the Bible says that the Pharisees defiled the Sabbath. The men at the temple defiled the Sabbath, yet they were guiltless because they were performing all the things that had to be performed on the Sabbath day. But that was the law, and the law had not been invalidated at any point until Jesus was nailed to the cross. But what happened when he was nailed to the cross? The law is still here. Can you go out and kill somebody? Can you go out and commit adultery? Is that okay? That is part of the law, isn't it? Thou shalt not kill. Can you go out and kill? Can you do anything that's against the law? No. The Bible says all the law is fulfilled in one word. This is in Galatians, the fifth chapter. All the law is fulfilled in one word, even in this, thou shalt love thy neighbors thyself. That word love is agape. Agape is walking in the commandments of God. The commandments are still here, but not any of the rituals of the law. They're all blotted out. Jesus became the Passover lamb. And I can't go into all of this. The Passover is spiritual. Cup of blessing was the third cup of the Passover. And Paul said in 1 Corinthians, the 10th chapter, he said, verse 16 and 17, he said, the cup of blessing which we bless it, not the communion of the blood of Christ. That cup of blessing was a term for a Passover cup. We don't pass around cups of the Passover to drink of a cup meant to undergo a death. It was the same thing as a blood baptism. Now, look here in, go back to Colossians. You realize that what I was teaching on tonight has to do with the children in the wilderness. Huh? Everything I teach on leads into everything else I teach on. I'd like to keep on going on baptism, but there's one baptism. I'll say it again. Jesus was baptized not so he could be saved. That's ridiculous. Jesus was baptized in the halakha. In this halakha, they said, these rabbis said, if you would undergo these three things, this is a real important part of this, if you would be circumcised, washed in water, offer two turtle doves, they said in their halakha that if you do these three things, even if you were a Gentile, and you were if you were a wise man, you'd go through these three things. They said they, by their own halakha, that they would have to listen to you. And they called Jesus a Samaritan. They said, well, he's from Samaria. They didn't know he was born in Judea, and he's not going to tell them that he was born in Bethlehem of Judea. He said, all I'll have to do, they know I've been circumcised. They could look at me and see. He said, they know my mother offered two turtle doves. I'm of the tribe of Judah. They know that. The only thing they don't know, they've never seen me washed in water. But they think I was born in Nazareth. And they considered Nazareth one of the most filthy places on the face of the earth. So they said, he's a Nazarene. We can kill him. All he had to do was wash in water, and that it would silence their mouths. They set that up. I think God had them set it up. And here's why Jesus was washed in water in John, the first chapter. I'll come back to Galatians. John, the first chapter. They called him a Pharisee again. They called him a Samaritan again. They hated Samaria. Samaria was the capital city of northern Israel, and they began to call the entire section of northern Israel Samaria. Let me say it again. The reason they hated Samaria, they hated it, northern Israel. It sure did come in handy for Jesus when he would say something down here in southern Judah. When he would say something to them, he'd call them generation of vipers. He'd call them liars and devils. And if this is Israel, this is southern Judah, this is northern Israel here, northern Israel up here, and the temple was down here in Benjamin, and that was with southern Judah. So when Jesus had come down to say something to the Pharisees, and they'd get mad when they'd say something, when he said, before Abraham was, I am, he was calling himself the I Am God of the Old Testament, they'd pick up stones to stone him. And the crowd was so heavy, this is one of the three feasts they had to come back to. All he had to do was move a little in the crowd. And if he stepped back across the border into Samaria, they wouldn't dare step in that. They said, that's the filthiest place on the earth. The reason for that, the reason them thinking that, is because when the Assyrians came down to carry northern Israel away into captivity in 722 B.C., they said when they came down, they moved into Israel, brought their Assyrian sun gods into Israel, and they said, and the sun worship was mixed with Jehovah worship in northern Israel. And the Pharisees said, since you've polluted the Word of God by mixing Jehovah worship with Assyrian sun and tree god worship, they said, that's filthy. But they didn't realize in their halakha they had mixed their opinion with God's law. They were doing worse than the Samaritans were doing here. And that's why they hated him so much. They said Jesus was born up here in the land of Zebulun, one of the sons of Israel or Jacob, but they didn't know he was born in Bethlehem down here. And he's not going to tell them. If somebody wants me to prove something about myself as to whether this message is true or not, what credentials do you have, Jim Brown? My credentials that I've spent 60 years studying this book. I'm not going to swear anything to people and say, I can prove this about myself. If you don't like what I'm preaching, go away. If you don't like it on the TV, there's a button over there that says off. So when they kept calling him Samaritan, all he needed was those three things, and he already had two of them by birth. Mary took him into Jerusalem to be circumcised. Well, he was circumcised, and then she took him into Jerusalem to offer the two turtle doves there in that first chapter of Luke. All he needed was water, and as a Samaritan, they would have to listen to him. They can think all they wanted to think. Well, here's why John said this over here in John. In John, the first chapter, John 1, this is why these words are written in here. And people don't have any, Baptist preacher don't have any idea why Jesus said this, or why John the Baptist said this. Verse 29, John 1, the next day John seeth Jesus coming unto him, saith, Behold the Lamb of God that takes away the sin of the world. Here's the Passover Lamb. This is he of whom I said, After me cometh a man which is preferred before me, for he was before me, and I knew him not, but that he should be made manifest to Israel, therefore am I come baptizing with water. So it'll shut the mouth of the Pharisees. That's why Jesus said to John the Baptist, Let's fulfill all righteousness. Let's fulfill the righteousness of the Pharisees. You wash me in water. They'll have to listen to me. They set that up in their halakha. Do you realize, I've said this before, but let me just say this again. Do you realize that when Jesus came on the scene, no one in the world was telling the truth except John the Baptist? That's all. No one. The Pharisees were out there preaching halakha on agada, twisting the word of God. That's why Jesus kept saying in that fifth chapter of Matthew, his first message, the Sermon on the Mount, it hath been said by these guys when they were the rabbis of the Babylonian synagogue. But I say, he would say, they're liars. I'm telling you the truth. So John the Baptist was the forerunner. A forerunner was one who come running into a city and saying, The king is here. Everyone get on your face. So everything that Jesus had to say and had to do with the Pharisees, and I can't get a hold of preachers who'll say, John said, There comes one after me who'll baptize you with the Holy Ghost and fire, and then Jesus would have the Jesus is God. He wouldn't tell them to go out there in the world and dip in water. He said, Go baptize with my baptism. And that's what they were doing. And that was proselyte baptism that the Ethiopian eunuch went through in Acts, the 8th chapter. It was proselyte. He wasn't Ethiopian. He was a eunuch. And I don't have, and Philip did not tell him to be baptized in water. He did not. The Ethiopian eunuch said, What doth hinder me to be baptized? Because he was just coming from a festival of the Pharisees. And Philip said, You're permitted, if you believe. You're permitted to become a member of Israel, the kingdom of God. He was believing spiritually, but in order to be a proselyte Jew, he had to undergo this process. Now go over here to Colossians. I'm adding to this baptism series. I'm adding more things to it out of the scripture. And he says, now, I don't know if anybody's even gotten this. I've never had anybody comment on it. Gentile church. Before Jesus was nailed to the cross, I've never heard anybody mention contracts. Never. Look up contract in your McClintock and Strong. It'll tell you about contracts. They had to perform a contract. Jesus was performing a contract when he said, This is my body. Take, eat, this is my body. There's one body. The body's the church. He's saying, partake of the body of Christ. It was a contract. To have a contract, you acted out this little one-act play in public. Ezekiel did that several times, laying on his side for 390 days, laying on his other side for 60 days. This was a contract. I'm not going to go into spelling it all out. That was a contract. That was a contract. Jesus said, this is the New Testament in my blood. Testament was a contract. It meant last will and testament. That's the last contract you leave upon the earth when you die, is the last will and testament. And he acted it out for him. Drinking of a cup was undergoing death. You can look at contracts, they'll tell you. When they wanted to invalidate a contract, they would take the two original parties that went into this contract with each other. And they had to have two witnesses according to the Old Testament scripture. So they'd take the two witnesses and say, is everybody in agreement? We're going to invalidate this contract. They'd say, yes. And they'd drive a nail through it. That's exactly what he's getting at here in Colossians, where he says, you're circumcised with a little circumcision before this, but now it's a circumcision made without hands. It's a circumcision of the heart. Cut off the foreskin of your heart. All through the Bible, it keeps talking about that. And then he says, buried with him in baptism. Well, do you think if the circumcision in verse 11 is spiritual, the baptism is literal? He's talking to Gentiles who would have had to gone through the three-point process before Jesus was nailed to the cross. This is after Jesus was nailed to the cross. He's not talking about a literal circumcision, and he's not talking about a literal baptism, because he has said in verse 8 that these will spoil you and lead you into darkness, into captivity as believers, if you're going to continue to go into all of this, all of these literal rituals. I believe Paul is telling the Colossians, literal rituals will put you in darkness. I'm absolutely sure of that. Buried with him in spiritual baptism, wherein also you're risen with him through the face of the operation of God. If the baptism is literal, then the resurrection would be literal here. You'd have to die as you're dipped into water and be resurrected as you come out of it and say, oh, I died under the water. It's ridiculous statements I'm making. The faith of the operation of God who has raised him from the dead. Now notice, there's a spiritual circumcision and a spiritual baptism. If this is before the death of Christ, this would be a literal circumcision and a literal. And then he says, here's the straightening out of it. He says that down here in verse 14, blotting out the handwriting of rituals. We're going to blot out the literal circumcision and blot out the water washing. That's what he's saying. But you're not going to know this if you don't know anything about the Pharisees, anything about the Halakhon, the Haggadah. Blotting out the handwriting of rituals that was against us, which was contrary to us, took it out of the way, nailing it to his cross. How are you going to know what that means if you don't look up contracts? I've never heard anybody talk about halakha in my life. I got it in all kinds of books. The best books I've got on it is the Compendia. And it's the Jews. In the first century. And then that's volume one. And you get volume two. It's another exposition of the Jews in the first century. And when you get this compendia, the life of the Jews in the first century, you'll get all kinds of stuff. And you got two volumes. You got volume one and volume two on Haggadah, Halakha, oral law. It'll say oral law. It'll say Tosefta. Tosefta means an addition to the oral or the written law. It'll have all these kind of things on it. Magnificent books. And most people would never recommend them and never read them. I've never heard them referred to. I got them in 20 years ago, something like that, maybe longer than that, started studying it. I thought, goodness gracious, where does, and you've got all kinds of book written on it. You'll see things on Torah. I saw that all my life. I didn't know it was the first five books of the Bible from the Jewish perspective, and I didn't know that when they translated over here to Babylon, and they translated all this to Babylon in their Aramaic, that they added all their opinions, and their opinions was their commentaries. And the halakha, they could add anything they wanted to it. But here's what I was getting at. So all the rituals of the Sabbath day were nailed to the cross. Everything they did on the Sabbath. All that they did at the Passover was nailed to the cross. All the things that they did and said. Well, where's the Passover now? You have to balance these things out. In Exodus 12th chapter, that's the first Passover. Where's the spiritual Passover? They had to give a for a lamb without blemish. Well, where's the Passover now? Does anybody remember? 1 Corinthians, the 5th chapter, the spiritual Passover is right there. Didn't they offer a lamb at the spiritual Passover? Well, who's the lamb now? That's what it says right here. 1 Corinthians 5th chapter, a man's having an affair with his stepmother, and he's called the leaven of the spiritual Passover, and you had to get all the leaven of the house in the house, out of the house, and burn it before the Passover began on that afternoon. On the 10th day of the 7th month. 14th day of the 1st month. And he says, deliver this man to Satan for the destruction of the flesh, there in verse 5, that the spirit may be saved in the day of the Lord. Your glowing is not good. Know you not that a little leaven of this spiritual Passover is leaveneth the whole church? Purge out therefore the old leaven, that you may be a new lump, as ye are unleavened, for I, even Christ, our Passover lamb, is sacrificed for us. So if the Passover lamb is the spiritual Passover, that's Christ, then don't pass around crackers and grape juice. They were eating the Passover. I got a million things to sell on this, and I can't say it all. Had four items at the Passover. A lamb without blemish. I think that's Jesus, isn't it? Right here. They had four cups. The third cup was called cup of blessing. Well, that's what it says over there in the 10th chapter of this book, the cup of blessing which we bless. Is it not the communion of the blood of Christ? 10:16. That's Passover term. But it's against Jewish law in their rituals to drink blood, especially human blood. So we, to drink of a cup, this cup is the New Testament in my blood, a testament. Diatheke was the last will and testament. And a testament has no force without the death of the testator. It had no force until Christ died. Those rituals wouldn't help. The blood of bulls and goats do not take away sin. Now go back over here to Colossians. This takes us right back into resting in the Sabbath. The Sabbath is spiritual now, because spiritual is the only thing. You can't have a Passover with a literal lamb. You have to have Christ, the spiritual Lamb of God. You can't have it with little bread. We being many are one bread and one body. And then he says down here, blotting out the handwriting of ordinances, contrary to us, took it out of the way. Now, that's a contract. And they establish a new contract, a new testament. Last will and testament. Testament, diatheke, means last will and testament. And now we have a last will and testament of Christ, diatheke. It is the last will and testament of Christ that we drink the cup. This cup is the New Testament, the new last will and testament. How much time do I have, Mike?
13.
Now look over here in Colossians 2. I've never stopped and gotten real slow over here in Colossians 2. Blot it out, take it out of the way, nailing it to his cross, and having spoiled, carried away principalities, that's heads. A principality is a place where prince rules, the prince of this world. He made a show of them openly, triumphing over them in it. Then he says, I have nailed all the rituals to the cross. Let no man therefore judge you in ritual meats in Leviticus, the 11th chapter. I've nailed them to the cross. Or in drink offerings, over in Leviticus, or in respect of any holy day and the rituals that go with it. Don't let anybody judge you in that. Or of a new moon, a new moon started with a ritual. You had all three of God's holy days, Passover, Pentecost, and they were packed full of rituals. They had month Nisan. In the month Nisan, there was Nisan 14. That was March, April. 50 days later, this was Passover here. And it was called a new moon. The first of every month was called a new moon. And they sounded a trumpet. The sound of the first trumpet at the first festival of God giving them crops. Boy, that all goes back to that, doesn't it? That's where they didn't want to have these sabbatical years and not planting every 7 years. So they just went after all these other fertility gods. And 50 days after Passover is Pentecost. In the month Sivan, and that's what's happening in Acts 2. And then in the month Tishri, you had seven straight months. Tishri was the month September, October. And they had these rituals for seven straight months. That was their ecclesiastical year. The harvest ended down here in Tishri. They had seven trumpets sounding. At the last trump was the ingathering. That's called the Feast of Tabernacles. And will be changed at the last trump when the sheep are separated from the goats. And don't let any man judge you that you have to take these rituals and keep them. The rituals are nailed to the cross. Then he says, a new moon, don't let anybody judge you of a new moon or Sabbath days, which are a shadow. Therefore, the Sabbath, according to the third and fourth chapter of Hebrews, is now resting. And it takes us in that third chapter of Hebrews, We are spiritual Israel traveling through the wilderness of this world, and God's going to kill off all unbelief. They could not enter in because of unbelief, and that means no truth. They weren't abiding by the truth of God, and God had put them through this wilderness, and there were so many that didn't believe God, and He starts killing them off. And we have an inner and an outer man, and the inner man insists that the outer man die. And that's our daily cross. That's death to self. And when you get to death to self, you get to a place as you get older, you'll say, I have to stop this worrying that I do. And then you'll begin to realize that God has ordained all things. He works all things into this wilderness after the counsel of His own will. And He tells us, in everything you're going through, give thanks. It's not a literal Israel anymore. It's spiritual Israel. They are not Israel which are of Israel. The election obtains this, and the rest are blinded. As many as walk according to the rule of a new creature, that's God's Israel. And what we're supposed to be doing, we're supposed to be resting, involving in the spiritual Sabbath. All those rituals that He's talking all through here, when He says, beware lest any man spoil you, the philosophy of vain deceit after the rituals of man. And He says, here's two rituals that Colossians had to partake in. They had to partake in circumcision, and they had to partake in washing of water, and they had to, this was before Jesus was nailed to the cross. And then he says, God's blotted out all these rituals that'll spoil you and lead you into captivity. It'll put you back in prison, put you in darkness. I believe America is in darkness. Even a lot of the believers, because they're following this. The Bible says in Ephesians, the fourth chapter, He says, if you listen to these winds of doctrine, which are full of rituals, they'll take you to a place where you're walking in the vanity of your mind, there in verse 17. Your thinking is twisted. The reason people's thinking is twisted, they don't believe in studying anything for themselves. They think, my preacher has all the answers, I'll listen to him. Most of the preachers I know don't have any answers. They're not going to study books. You got to get reliable information. These are reliable men, just like the Hastings is reliable. These are written by real conservative Bible believers. So if the Sabbath is spiritual, and it was a shadow in the Old Testament, it's the real thing now. God wants us to rest, and that's what He says in Hebrews 3. And this takes us all the way back over to what we've been studying over there in the book of Numbers. How much time do I have, Mike?
5 minutes.
5 minutes. All right. I want us to go back over to Numbers. That leads us right into Numbers. Because everything that Israel went through, God planned it over here in the wilderness. He planned all those obstacles in front of them. He said, all I want you to do is believe me. Quit murmuring against me, like the third chapter and the fourth chapter of Hebrews says. I want you to come to a place of resting in all that you're doing. Forget the rituals. Forget going to church to sit on a front row or sit halfway back so you can feel like you met your obligation to God, because I got baptized and I take the cracker and the grape juice. That won't do a thing for you. Nothing. It'll lead you way into captivity, and you'll think you're doing right, and you're not. So it actually takes us back to Numbers, and where we got to, we got over to the 17th chapter. And I'm not going to read that. I'm just going to say this about the 18th chapter. The 18th chapter is about the tithe. And the tithe had no rituals with it. People say the tithe has been blotted out. It has not. I'll come back to that next week. The tithe is not blotted out. The rituals. There was no ritual to the tithe. They came to the priest every Friday evening, what you and I call Friday evening at sundown, and they gave their tithe to the priest. And the Bible says that what the priest got here in the, it says that in the ninth chapter of 1 Corinthians, whatever the priest received, that's what the preacher of the church is supposed to receive. I don't know what people think I can't pay these lights and pay five salaries and pay for $12,000 a month TV bill on my good looks. I don't even have them anymore. You can't pay bills with amen, brother. God bless you. And he tells us this tithe that went to the priesthood in the 18th chapter of Numbers goes to the preacher. He says that in 1 Corinthians. I'll just read that one more time. 1 Corinthians. I'll come back and go through this. We're trying to go through the book of Numbers, but I got to thinking about all the rituals that were going on in Numbers that were given to them in Exodus and Leviticus. These have all been blotted out. The Jew is spiritual, circumcision is spiritual, baptism is spiritual, and there's only one baptism. It's got to be blood or water. Can't be anything else. And I'm going to come back and go into that 18th chapter and go through this thing called the tithe. Again, the tithe has not been done away with. The Pharisees came to Jesus and said, "We tithe every week." And Jesus said, "This ought you have done. You should have done this, but you've omitted the weightier points of the law. You've omitted faith and trust and grace and all the rest of this." They were ritual people. Rituals are devastating to the spiritual life. If you think you need to be dipped in water, then you don't need to be dipped in the Spirit, which is the truth. The truth is the Word of God, and you don't need to be saturated with the Word of God. People get mad at me for preaching so many details. The details of the Word is what you need, not the rituals that they performed over there in the Old Testament. All right, I'm going to come back and go to that. I'm going to try to get through. I'm teaching Numbers, but every chapter in Numbers doesn't have the people angry at God, but it works right into another chapter real quick, and they were in the wilderness provoking God to anger. Well, let's go to the Lord in prayer. Lord, thank you for truth. Help us to see these things. The more I preach it, the more I see it. Help me to help the people to see your word, get away from ritualistic things. That's what Christmas is. It's a ritual. Doing it every year, and rituals pollute, lead away. Help us, Lord. Help me. I'm tired, Lord. I need your help. Strengthen me. Strengthen the people in the church. Lead me and Mary where you'd have us to go and what you'd have us to do. She's sick, Lord. She's in your hand. And we'll give you praise for everything. Lead us to your elect family. And cause us to rest more in all the things that's going on. In Christ's name we pray, amen. I didn't mean to go back to that, but I was going to go back to the Sabbath being a shadow. Well, when it says the Sabbath is a shadow, that nails these people to the wall. Especially when he just got through saying, blotting out the handwriting rituals. I'm sorry, but I can't quit preaching when I get on some subjects. I really love teaching on spiritual baptism. If there is a spiritual baptism, there is not a literal. That's the point. People depend on their water, once in a while you talk to somebody, well, I got baptized when I was 8. Yeah. Well, that didn't help you. Don't do nothing for you. I won't be doing any of that.
Which, while I was there, I thought I was just being just holy.